Welcome back to our talk studio, where we're delighted to have with us Aden Duale and James Orengo, who've been standing by with Sunday Live. Now, Aden, I'll start with you, because, of course, the bill that is seeking to withdraw Kenya from the Rome Statute is expected to be tabled in the House today by yourself. Please give us the what can we expect this week from you?
Well, I don't think whether we are going to table the bill by Thursday. Mm-hmm. The bill now is in a draft form. And there's a whole period of that's why the bill took long. We call the pre-publication period. And then once we have the draft, we will, this will give it to the legal department of parliament and the speaker. You know, under the new dispensation, all bills come through parliament. So once the speaker is through with it, and then let's say hope maybe by Thursday, send it for publication.
So you expect
then
it to take?
Once it is published, mm-hmm. then again the bill will go through the publication period of 14 days. Then after that, it will come for first reading, and then it's sent to a committee of parliament. Most likely it's going to be the Legal and Justice Affairs Committee of Parliament that will have 21 days. And the bill only seeks to repeal the International Crimes Act within the Constitution. So that is the one that domesticates the Rome Statute. So it's like having Kenya being a member of the Rome Statute, but not ratifying it. So that's the process. The other important thing, event that is happening this week is the deferral by government, which is
before
today,
the UN Security
yes, today
Council.
There was to be a consultative meeting between the African members of the Security Council, Rwanda, Togo, and Morocco, plus the the foreign ministers of the five countries from the African Union, from all the regions, Namibia, Senegal, Mauritania, Uganda, and Ethiopia, who are the chair of African Union, and of course Kenya, had a consultative meeting, put the agenda for the plenary, and tentatively we are told the UN Security Council will deal with the Kenyan matter on the 31st
So the UN Security Council will deal with a deferral request before we see the tabling of the bill in Parliament, most likely.
Yes.
And before I move to James, there's still a lot of comment that people feel this is a very selfish move. It's you know, focused on two individuals. It was meant to be a personal problem. How do you respond to that?
I think I wish I had more time to explain that. In 1998, Kenya joined and signed the Rome Statute, among many, many other African countries, and world countries. But the framers and the objective of the Rome Statute, in our opinion, from where we sit now, feel that that has not been achieved. And the ICC, or the Rome Statute, needs to undergo a serious reform, reform. And I'll give you the reasons why we feel.
I want James to come in now with his thoughts, because he's going to comment on that. And James, of course, a big meeting this Tuesday for CORD, looking at their position on these very critical issues. Yes. What are you going to be proposing as one of the veteran lawyers of the team?
I think there's no proposals on the table. Mm-hmm. I think we are going to have a clean slate, as it were, and to give members opportunity to come out with the type of ideas they have. There have been members of parliament belonging to the CORD coalition who have been talking to their counterparts in Jubilee. But I think to answer the basic question on the question of withdrawal or not, or deferral or not, I think whatever we do in that respect, it is not going to help the present circumstances or even the future circumstances. For example, a deferral does not terminate the proceedings. I would be going for a mechanism which would bring those proceedings to an end. Because if you're going to defer for 12 months, the country is still going to be under
It's still not a solution.
It's still not a solution.
If there are issues with
And the solution exists within the ICC statute. And Kenya has been advised many times that you left the horses off the stable at the appropriate time that you should have taken action. For example, even at the time that Ocampo sent a notice, he sent a notice, which is mandatory under the ICC statute, that I'm giving you 30 days. If you don't engage any investigations, then I'm going to do it.
James, a mistake made.
Yes, yes.
And certainly a lot of calls, even the East African Legislative Assembly this weekend, I think, has thrown its weight behind the AU and the Kenya move. But let's just look at this and ask ourselves, would any developed country, this question is to you specifically, would any developed country allow its head of state to be present in such a court? And secondly, what are your thoughts on the standard that the court has in terms of evidence, in terms of procedure? Yeah. What are your thoughts on the standard that we
see? Well, on the first question, in the developed nations, I don't think that issue would arise. Before the event, one would seek to leave office.
But in any case, would they?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, is that it would not arise. But if they insisted, you know, it would be like the other tribunals, you know, like in after the First World War. There were the tribunals after the First World War. During the Second World War, there were the Tokyo tribunals, which tried, you know,
Axis powers. Not the others.
Yes. And it was a victor's justice. That was what was wrong with it. Mm-hmm. And therefore, you know, the international community was looking for a mechanism, which is permanent, a permanent criminal court. And in this statute, the states, the statute that was negotiated, you know, you really have to sleep on the job to get the ICC to take over proceedings in
the country. We slept on the job.
I think there are a number of fundamental issues I want to clarify. Number one, and this is a notion that has been put on the table a number of times. It's not Kenya that took itself to ICC.
Everyone who's watching is saying, don't be vague, go to the Hague.
No. I think that's the word that people have been saying. Mm. It is the committee of the eminent personalities led by Kofi Annan who took the Kenya after we could not set up the local tribunal. So it's them who referred, picked the envelope, picked the documents, of the working documents, took them to the ICC. So it's not the Kenya government that took itself there. Number two, look at even that period that we were to set up the local tribunal. What state was the Kenyan nation? It was just a few months after the post-election violence. Kenya needed reconciliation, healing by then. So in fact, if 2 years down the line, Kenya, under new constitution, Kenyan parliament could have maybe voted otherwise. But let me tell you, Look at the ICC, and that's why I'm one of the skeptics of ICC. Look at ICC. The US is not a member, and I want to make it very clear that the values of good governance, the values of democracy, the values of human rights is in Kenya. I mean, that's why we voted for a new constitution. We have reform institutions. But if you allow me, Julie, look at the speed in which the Kenyan case and the Ivorian case were the speed in which they referred to the ICC. Compare that with even today's scenario of Syria.
Let me bring that to James.
You know, there's a lot of dishonesty in Africa. You know, the court trying the Rwanda court in Arusha. When the international court, the international community did not intervene in Rwanda, everybody was making noise that, you know, Big Brother, you have left 1 million Africans be killed without making an intervention. The Rwandan court is being hosted by an African country. It is an international ad hoc criminal court, and the crimes that are recognized under ICC are the same crimes that are being tried by the court in Arusha. The court, in regard to the Sierra Leonean situation, it was a mixed court because there were Sierra Leonean judges and officers and international jurists. But it was being hosted by an African country.
I think we're applying hypocrisy.
Let me ask this,
gentlemen. The Waki list and the names that came out of that list. Let's start there. Do you think that there is some hypocrisy in the fact that the principals were not on that list?
No, let me tell you. If you look at the little documentation that is coming from ICC, you'd conclude that the WACI list was actually relevant. A lot of the material is coming from the intelligence.
So investigations
was done by the intelligence. In fact, you would find, let me tell you, and this is very important, in respect even to the president's case, you'll find that, you know, Uhuru Kenyatta ended up with the ICC as opposed to any other person in PNU because of the internal wrangles within the PNU.
I think this is the opportunity when Kenya must relook at the 2007-2008 post-election violence. A commission was formed called the WACI Commission within the framework of the Legal Commission of Inquiry Act. Section 7 of the Commission Act of Inquiry Act says the report must be given, it's paid by Kenyan taxpayers, the report must be given to the head of state. And by then, the two principals, Honorable Raila Odinga, Honorable Mwai Kibaki, that didn't happen. An envelope came, and this petition is coming to Parliament. An envelope was created with, I think, 16, 20 names. I think it is morally right, very just, for even the ICC to tell that, fine, we picked 6 names, the other 14 names, Honorable Duale is there, Honorable James Orengo is there, XYZ. I mean,
transparency is what you're asking for.
Yes, no, and that's what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. Before the end of this parliament, a petition will come. And even Justice Waki, the secretary of that commission, Kigoro, need to come and tell the country, because the ICC is a public interest, it's a serious issue. But if I go back to what...
I'm going
to
stop you just for a moment.
When you were there, what Jimmy said, I'm not talking about the African context. Look at the African context vis-a-vis the other...
I'm stopping you both for just one moment.
He's being on the defensive throughout.
James, one moment. Yeah. To just say to Justice Philip Waki, we would love to host you on Sunday Live, and we do feel it's important to get to the bottom of the Waki results, the findings, and you're most welcome to this show to look into that. Gentlemen, we're quickly coming to the time limit on this, but I want to change the game a little bit here. And I want to ask each of you to sit back and look at the merits of the case on the other end. Because Kenya is facing terrorist threats. We're facing huge internal security challenges. Right now we're looking at our judiciary, who seem to be cannibalizing on gains that happened, the reforms in the sector. And we're at a critical phase of development. As leaders in this country, I'm asking you, yes, partisan politics is practiced, but can we find common ground? And where is the common ground in the interests of Kenya? I'll start with you, Aden, and then with you, James, and then with you, and you, Aden.
Me, I think, first of all, the common ground would exist if we comply with the law, because that is a starting point. Even a lot of problems that are facing our institutions, including the judiciary, is loyalty and obedience to the law. If we stick to that, I think a lot of our problems will get out of the way.
To respect for the rule of law.
For the rule of law. In respect to ICC and what can be done, there should be a quick closure. And if I was a lawyer sitting for Uhuru Kenyatta or the deputy president and Uhuru Kenyatta the president, I'd look at the case. You know, the unique thing about the proceedings in ICC, you get the substance of the evidence that is being or is going to be adduced against you. And you can make a quick assessment as to whether or not, you know, you really have a strong case against you. And I think Deputy President Ruto has done a good thing, because I think what he's looking at is quick closure. And that is good for the country. Similarly, for the president, I've seen that now they have filed an application where they want a permanent stay of the proceedings, which in legal parlance is really termination of the proceedings because of abuse of process. It's got two ways of bringing those proceedings to an end, through that application or asking for an expeditious hearing.
So you're saying that even this deferral is not an answer.
We're just going to be the political deferral. But even the Security Council is acting under a chapter of the United Nations, the provisions of the United Nations Charter, mm-hmm. where they must be seen to be strictly following what is provided in the Charter. And, you know, that Charter applies both in terms of referral and also deferral. And those circumstances must be met.
Thank you, James. Some advice for President Kenyatta from James Orengo there. Yeah. And the time is very short.
And I think the common ground we need to develop is we need to look at we have a very robust constitution. We have created some institutions that we feel can take Kenyans very far. And I think we need to differentiate between the national good and the individual and political partisan interests. So I think the national good comes first, and I think as a country, we need to stand together. And of course, we are facing serious internal and regional security, very extraordinary. The jihadis have come all the way from Afghanistan. We're living in.
They've come from Norway, we are told.
Yes, yes. Mm. So we have a serious both internal and regional security. But I think for us, the ICC, from where I sit, I'm sure the president, the deputy president, have a serious and the best of the legal minds to handle their cases, mm. whether it will be deferral or the president will use excusal, and the deputy president will go back and that. But I think for the country and for the coalition that I represent, mm-hmm. of course we have a serious misgivings on the whole Kenyan case, both. Both locally and internationally. Let me tell you.
We're winding up, Aden. I'm going to allow you a final comment and then give James a final word.
Comment. Yes. Mm. If you allow me, in 2011, when the Kenyan government approached the UN Security Council, local politics played a role. I mean, the party that I was at by then wrote to the UN objecting to that. Today, a handful of NGOs who we know their side of the story, AFRICOG, ICJ, Muhuri. I mean, this is the document they wrote to the UN Security Council.
They're not with us.
So what I'm saying is...
And you can't blame them. We've got an open system.
Judy, if you give me a minute, we have the documents African Union submitted. So even these are public documents. But what I'm saying is this, in a nutshell. Kenya is a member of the Rome Statute. Our Attorney General, our Foreign Minister, does not get the hearing. Some civil society down Nairobi downtown gate.
And James, you have the final word.
Look at it. They didn't quite get a hearing. They just wrote within the context of the statute to the ICC.
Do you understand the concerns of partisanship when it comes to civil society?
Partisanship, you know, elements of civil society and government, they're in opposition, mm-hmm. they're all over.
Okay.
In fact,
so
part of the problem that we have in Kenya today is that every government comes, it consumes the civil society.
That
so you've got to develop a new component of civil society. But one of the things that the African countries should be doing, which some countries which are not happy with the ICC did, and when we had a review conference in Kampala about 2 years ago, and there was very heavy representation from both sides of the political divide, including some of the people in government today, where we were discussing the statute, the review of the statute, and the U.S. has been concerned about the crime of aggression. What is the definition? And they were not prepared to be members.
And I'm stopping you there because the U.S. were also concerned about the term genocide some years back.
Let me tell you just this. The other thing African countries can do is the statute itself. It can be amended. And you feel that, you know, the court has too much powers.
I ended there with the words James and Aden. We could continue all night with the words of the East African Legislative Assembly, which recommends that in the region we establish our own court, which then is perhaps not controlled by one nation.
But we established them and we killed them. The East African Court of Appeal was killed.
And there we expect leadership. And that's why we look to the leaders who are elected. We look to you, and why I said, where do we find as a nation our common ground? And one of the things we've been told today is it's in the respect for the rule of law. Thank you, gentlemen, for a very civilized discussion around an issue that is far too hot. We'll be back in the other studio in just a short while. I look forward to seeing you then.
Thank you, Julie.
Thank you.